pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it.
Morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have a dangerous dish on camera with me today. Chuckle, chuckle. And it is a chilly 9 degrees C, about 47 Fahrenheit. We are still in search of the mating leopards that I heard on yesterday's sunset safari, but in our search I spotted some male lion tracks and they were heading towards Sydney's waterhole, so we're going to go have a look. And it's beautiful. This morning we're going to have an awesome sunrise just now. Now that male lion's walked through here somewhere. It's going to be on the Game Drive radio, updating the other guys about those male lion tracks. Let's just have a quick look in this open area. Come on, lion. Now, as those of you who missed yesterday's sunset safari, they found another dead elephant on Buffalo's Hook, and unfortunately have a feeling that these lion tracks are going to go straight towards that area. Ah, there we go. I've just heard that Abel and Buffalo's Hook can hear these lions we're tracking. So we'll just have a quick look at the waterhole. You never know, there might be a late lion following through. Remember, we're on a live African safari, and for questions to us out here in the middle of the bush, you can use the hashtag Safari Live or the email address questions@wildearth.tv.
I think that could be the same Nkonzo I've just got now. There's Nkonzo of Wanunangala heading north across Sandy Patch.
Okay, so let's have a quick look at the waterhole. Oh, warning. What have we got there? Oh, it's an African harrier hawk, one of them, or the second one. Let's have a quick look. Yes, both of them, African harrier hawks. All still at Sydney's waterhole, so we're going to head east along the northern boundary. While we do that, let's go to Jamie so she can bid you a good morrow.
Good morning and welcome on this winter's morning sunrise safari. My name is Jamie and I have Jandre on camera with me, and together while Brent searches the northern boundary, we are going to go and follow up on where Karula was yesterday. I'm really hoping she's still around. I'm a little bit doubtful because when we were there yesterday with her two lovely cubs, she had pretty much finished off what was left of her adult impala kill. Impressive work between the three of them to finish off an impala in pretty much 24 hours. All that was left was the head and a little bit of leg. And in fact, the carcass was being held on by a scrap of skin on the back leg, which makes me think there's a good chance that it has fallen down sometime in the night. Now Karula, being the wise mother that she is, I think once the kill is finished, she's going to move those cubs a little bit away from it so as not to put them at risk of scavenging hyenas. Karula is a leopard, by the way, for those of you who are joining us for the first time, and she's got two very sweet, very nearly 6 month old cubs with her that we got to watch yesterday being incredibly cute. Interesting. There's tracks in here. This isn't the way I went yesterday. Perhaps we could try going through here. That might be very interesting. Let's try it. Somebody made a road through here. because I think I actually missed the entrance in a little bit further up the road. Let's go through here, see if we can't poke our noses into the drainage line. Luckily for us, we've got our little short wheelbase Land Rovers, which are capable of getting us through all kinds of tricky situations and into all kinds of tricky places. The other vehicles have to go all the way around in order to get in here, but I think we might be okay. Let's see. Or perhaps has somebody hit an obstacle up ahead? You okay there, Jean-André? Sorry. Have a bush willow first thing in the morning. Just what you want for breakfast. Well, there you go. Ask and you shall receive. Everybody ducking? Good stuff. You okay? Just go for it. You sure? Okay. Jean-André's all in one piece. Marvelous. Good work. And down we go into the Mulwati drainage line. And so we go upon a river adventure. And actually, approaching from this angle was unintentional, but I think is a relatively good idea because it does give us a chance to check to see if she's moved further along to keep those little ones safe. Jean-André has spotted some vultures. This is where the big blockage is. Uh-oh. This isn't going to work, unfortunately. I forgot about this blockage that's up ahead. Let's go see, but I don't think we're going to get round here. Oopsie. I got so eager and excited I missed the initial road in. Travelled a little bit too far, a little bit too quickly. Just check she's not around here. This is one of her favourite spots. However, we have come to the end of the road. So a very short river adventure, because there is a very large tree in front of me. And from speaking from experience, we're not going to be able to get around that. No. Most definitely not. Whoopsie. Sorry. My morning eyes didn't manage to catch the off-road tracks. All right, we're going to go back on ourselves and do the rest of the river in reverse, and we'll send you back across to Brent while we do.
Well, it sounds like Jamie found an obstacle. Fortunately for me, my road is obstacle-free. I'm just driving very slowly along here, stopping every now and then and listening, seeing if we can hear anything of those leopards. Unfortunately, just after safari, I did hear them, but they had crossed north into Buffalo's Hook. Oh dear. One of those things, but they might still be around. What is that? It's a log. Morning, Michael! Michael, this is, who do you think the mating leopards might have been? I think it's a good chance. It's either Mvula or Gajima being the male. I think it might be Gajima, and that's when, during the day while we try to find him, he disappeared. So I think it might be Gajima. The female is more than likely Nkanyen's sister, the Shiluva 2005 model, not the 2013 model. The older model, and she was mating with Mvula a week or 10 days ago. So it's quite likely that her, if she didn't get pregnant, she'll come back and Isra start mating again. So I think it's more than likely her, because she was mating recently, and possibly with a different male. So I think it could be Gajima, the ghost from the north. So they crossed, I reckon, just up ahead here somewhere. Such a beautiful morning. The sun's
popping up over the eastern horizon. Not a cloud in the sky. I do love this time of the year. I'm even able to put up with the cold because I love the bush so much at this time of the year. Now, if we have no luck with these leopards, I'm going to check down towards the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. Maybe we'll go check down into the Mwati from the eastern boundary, give Jamie a hand, see if we can find any tracks of Krula. If she's not there, oh, hello. Fortunately, it's a Buffalo's Hook giraffe behind some bush. We have a nice silhouette nonetheless. Big male giraffe. Well, Nancy, you were hoping for a giraffe. Nancy, I aim to please, so here we go. Nice big male giraffe. Unfortunately, he is a little bit to the north of our traverse area, but we'll stick with him for a while. Also gives us a chance to listen to see if the dawn is broken by lion calls or leopard mating or any alarm calls. Isn't that quite beautiful? Oh, what have you spotted, Mr. Giraffe? Have you spotted us, or are you looking the other way? Now see, giraffe are excellent at spotting predators. So that giraffe is stopped and is staring. And this is the area where I thought more or less where those mating leopards went. What have you spotted, giraffe? Now, definitely seen something. You can see it could be an impala, it could be an inyala. If it does spot a predator, often they'll walk closer to inspect to make sure. Let's see what he does. No, I think he's happy that whatever he spotted wasn't a predator because he's not going in that direction. Oh, wasn't that beautiful? Such graceful animals. Now, as we watch that beautiful giraffe uses exquisitely long tongue. Shamsung's wondering, do giraffe ever alarm call? They've definitely got the advantage of height. Now, giraffe are one of the most silent animals in the bush. For a long time, they were thought to be completely silent. However, they can grunt and snort a little bit. Only time that really happens is during mating and when there's a couple of lions attached to their bottom and also during game capture. Now, giraffe are one of the hardest animals to catch in the bush. And what you have to do is you have to half sedate them so you don't give them a full dose of M99. And then comes the difficult part. It's actually very dangerous and also one of the more dangerous animals to do game capture on. Then you've got to run around those long legs that are capable of breaking a lion's jaw or killing a lion with one kick and with a big rope, and you've got to trip them and try to trip them gently. It's a very, very difficult process. But all is quiet. So let's leave that giraffe to his breakfast
and keep on our morning meanderings. One in Lula meet Tumbuti Dam. Okay, so I heard those leopards somewhere in this little river system up here. Someone was asking about that dead elephant. Sorry, I got sidetracked by the giraffe there. And what is killing all these elephants? Well, only two elephants have died so far, and it was Linda who was in Canada who was wondering about that. So I wouldn't say it's a lot of elephant, yes. Yet the population for the Great Kruger is about 17,000. So two elephants don't really affect the population. And Linda, it'll be the drought. And it's generally the older or ill animals or the young animals that suffer in the drought. And it is a form of natural selection. So evolution in action. So especially older elephants now on their last set of teeth, there's not very nutritious food around. So they're generally going to start. Well, it sounds like there's no lions on that dead elephant yet, which is good news for us, but there's a lot of vultures and some hyena. But sorry Linda, back to your question. So we've got some birdies. I saw, okay, zoom, we're not, and to the out a bit. I'm just trying to work out where you to the right. There we go. There's an arrow marked babbler on the ground. Have you got, there's another one. No, that's not the babbler. Well, that's, what have we got there? There's an interesting one. Well, I think I know what it is. I got a quick glimpse. There we go. Much better there. I think that's a good one to get the brains going. Who can tell me what bird that is? And if you know what bird that is, remember hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or use the email address questions@wildearth.tv. What bird is that? Oh, very pretty. And he's not the only bird scuttling about this area. There's some arrow marked babblers as well. You see them, where they gone? Up there. So come out and down. There we go, on the ground. You can see arrow marked babblers are less skulking than the other bird. He was skulking about. You see him sifting through the leaf litter, looking for any insects to eat. Live in very noisy flocks. They've been quite quiet for babblers at the moment. A very aptly named bird. So we've got our first answer. It's a white-browed scrub robin, and that unfortunately is not correct. But keep trying. Oh, look at that. Where are those bugs? Incredibly efficient at digging through the leaf litter. He flicks the leaf up with his beak or with his feet to see if there's any. Oh, here we go. No, was there something to eat there? It looks like it. Possibly some little Micromyces termites. The odd woodlouse trying to hide. Well, We've left the giraffe to his breakfast. Let's leave the arrow marked brabbler to his breakfast and keep moving. And while we do that, let's see if Jamie's had any luck in the Mawati River.
Found the spot, but unfortunately, as we expected, there is absolutely nothing there. No impala, and as far as I can tell, no spotted kitty cats anywhere underneath it. And look, you can actually see where the carcass fell down. There's a mark where it tumbled out of the tree and then down the soil onto the ground. And there it has been consumed by something. Oh, and our leopards have left us a deposit. I wish I knew which one of them. It probably must be Karula's there. There's some scat, some fresh scat, in a bundle there. Okay, so fresh Karula, fresh-ish Karula scat. And now the go-away birds are calling. But I think it's just their morning call. I definitely don't see any sign. Let's just go investigate. Let's just go backwards a little bit just to see what these... No, they've stopped now. If it were Karula, they'd still be calling. Let's go a little bit further along on our drainage line cruise. There's a way back out this way, so it gives us an opportunity to just double-check ever so carefully and try and work out where these cats have gone. So when we left them, Karula was sitting up on the bank close to the kill, and her two little ones were just off to the side. And I parked myself in this thorn tree. There we go. Okay. That's sort of what we expected. Always a little bit disappointing, but exciting nevertheless, because it means we get to go and search for Karula on this lovely morning. Find out where she's decided to go. There's a little dacre. Not often they sit still long enough for us to put them on camera. Hello, little one. One of our smallest antelope species, with their dark black face patches. That is one of the distinguishing features between a dacre and a steenbok, which is something that confuses first-time safari goers. Is which is which. Both of them are roughly the same size. The dacre is a little bit larger. But the steenbok does not have that black strip that runs up from the nose and finishes sort of between the eyes. Looks like this is a female. Can't see her properly. Let me try. I'm hoping she's going to stay. Let's try and go forward a little bit so that we can get those leaves out of our way. And welcome to Brian, watching all the way in Oklahoma. Brian says that he has heard that dacre are omnivores, and if that is true, what sort of food do they eat? I wouldn't call them omnivores, Brian. They're obligate herbivores, so they do. Their diet primarily consists of plant matter. That being said, more than any of the other antelope species out here, and most of them will do this, dacre will often go and find the remnants of carcasses and nibble on a little bit of meat in order to sustain, sort of to supplement their protein intake. And it can be anything. There's no specific type of food. Obviously, they don't actively hunt and kill, although that prospect, now that I mention it, is utterly terrifying. Imagine hunting dacre. Ooh, scary. So they won't actively seek out or kill anything. It's just if they happen to find a carcass that doesn't have a predator attached to it, then they will go and nibble on the bits of meat. And they do so more frequently than most of our other antelope species. Dacre and warthog are the two herbivores that spend a lot of their time, or can often, forage off carcasses. Bush pig as well, sorry, bush pig included. But a bush pig almost has an omnivorous diet. And we put up camera traps. I've put up camera traps before at carcasses, and you will often see dacre eating off them. That being said, that's not to be confused with the practice of osteophagy either, which is whenever an antelope picks up an old bone. That's different. That's not really feeding off a carcass so much as just basically the equivalent of taking a calcium supplement, a calcium and a phosphorus supplement. That's what they get from those bones. And they just grind them on their teeth and get that little powdery stuff off the surface of the bones, the calcium, essentially. But it's not the same thing. They will scavenge off fresh carcasses. And dacre have been recorded. Dacre have been recorded feeding off birds and eggs as well. So in a way, yes, they do actively hunt. They will catch, if they catch a bird or find a baby bird, they will eat it. For those of you who are long-term viewers, if you cast your mind back to probably about this time last year, there was the takeover from the Birmingham boys, and they kicked the Nkuhuma lionesses and junior off this buffalo kill. And this is where we were this time last year in this drainage line system watching them feed. And this is where we first realized that they had killed one of the Styx cubs, when one of the Birmingham boys picked it up in the bushes just behind this buffalo kill. So, a buffalo skull with a story, but while we move on from our buffalo skull, I believe that Brent has got a far luckier buffalo with him.
Parla. Sorry, I got slightly distracted. I thought I saw a big cat, but it was an impala, and just moving through the bush. So yes, we've got some particularly unhappy-looking buffalo. This one in particular looks at me like he literally wants to perform a grievous bodily harm. There, that's the one. And just look at his face. He really looks upset with life. He seems to have an injury to his left eye. A bit of a limp. Now, that is the most dangerous type of buffalo. An old boy carrying a few injuries. Hearing's probably not too good. And what happens is, while you're tracking or walking on foot, you surprise them in a thicket, because these old boys, quite often, we're right on the edge of a riverine thicket. And also with the drought, they're not going to be in the best condition. You got to be really careful of them at the moment. Just go forward a bit. Of course, they also spend a lot of their dry season trying to avoid lions. There's Grumpy. Just zoom quickly, Dave, on his right. You can see there's something with his eye. Maybe not. Oh, no, there is. He doesn't have one. Oh, there, and the oxpeck is trying to get in there. That's probably from a horn. It looks like he's actually burst his eye. Oh, look, the oxpeck is in his ear. And oxpeckers, incredibly, are able to digest large mammal earwax. Shame, old boy. He's just looking like he's very stiff. He's got that injury to his eye. And all those things will make sure he's in a bad mood. Now, big old buffalo like these, three boys that are moving through the bush here, probably around 12, 13 years old, right at the end of their lifespan. And I think we're going to have a few less old boys around at the end of the drought. Okay, bye, buffalo. Oh, it seems like this bird's creating a bit of difficulty for everyone. Come on, guys. I know it's early. It is a member of the shrike family.
It's definitely not a swallow. Let me have a look. Or a flycatcher. And it's not one we see as often or hear as often as the other. We get two here. And some of you are in the right family group, but the wrong individual. So that should be a hint. So the right family, wrong individual. So what we've been sneakily doing this morning is building our bird list without making a big deal out of it, because otherwise we seem to not be able to get there. So we started with some African harrier hawk, arrow-marked babbler, mystery bird. So African harrier hawk, arrow-marked babbler, mystery bird. What else, Dave? Oxpecker, red-billed oxpecker. No. I can hear him talking next to me, so he's calling for attention. There he is. What's that? Yellow-billed hornbill. Flappity flap. I do love it when they call like this. Oh, that was not a very elegant dismount, hornbill. Here we go. So the nice thing about early morning birding is there are lots of birds sunning themselves. Oh, Dave's going for a different one. What do you spot, Dave? Top of the tree, sitting in the sun, basking beautifully. I think there's one in the open to the right. A little bit to the right. There we go. Oh, lovely little canaries, yellow-fronted canary. We're on the edge of a little bird party. They're still sunning themselves, waiting for it to warm up before they start feeding. But frolicking about in this little combretum. I think it's... Oh, is he there? Is a little crombeck. Oh, there he goes. A little crombeck. Oh, off he goes. What else can we hear now? A little three blind mice. Can spot batters. So well done to George Anne and James Richard. The mystery bird was indeed a brown-crowned chagra. Yeah, so while we continue to check for lions, leopards, and birds, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Lions, leopards, and birds sounds like a marvelous recipe for the morning. I'm going to concentrate on trying to figure out where Karula and her cubs went from the point last night where that kill obviously fell out of the tree and they lost it to the hyenas. Sorry. This is an old track, but it took me by surprise. Sure, where did I even see it now? I got the angle exactly right. Oh. It's a huge hyena track, but it's very, very obscure. It's really difficult to see. I thought for a second it was a lion, but it's a hyena that's got a track about the size of a lioness. We have some female hyenas out here with absolutely enormous feet. Really are close to the size of a lioness's tracks. Right, what would Karula have done? She'd probably have gone for a drink. That being said, there's so much groundwater around that she wouldn't have had to go all the way to the pan. She could have just come to a spot like this puddle here. And there's lots and lots of these puddles around. Plenty of groundwater still, which means that the animals are not nearly as concentrated around the water holes as they might otherwise be, which is wonderful. It's wonderful for them. Clouds of steam rising from Wendy. That's just steam. Right, let's continue on our search for Karula. She hasn't popped out here. I think we should... Hey, Jondre, how do you feel about helping Brent with his list of things with feathers that we can't name because we can't call it what it should be in case the bird's here? There's a thrilled silence from Jondre at the back. The difficulty is, of course, on Wendy is that we don't actually have the camera that has the zoom capabilities that Brent has on the back of Rusty. That, of course, is changing, I hope, at some point, relatively soon. Yeah, it is indeed. Leonardo is giving me the thumbs up, so something exciting to stay on board for, where we kit out both cars in the same way. My suspicion, I hope I'm not right, my suspicion is she's going to walk all the way along the Mulwati drainage and out into Little Gowrie, because I haven't seen any tracks either popping up onto Vulture's Nest or onto Twin Dams. The soil's still a bit wet in places for us to see the tracks clearly, unless you get out and sort of scour the ground at a walking pace. But I think the fact that we haven't picked up on their tracks in patches of soft sand, she's going to travel along the drainage line, because essentially that works just as well as driving along a road for her, or walking along a road for her. And predators do use the roads. In fact, all animals use the roads, but predators most especially, because it is silent for them. They don't have to worry about walking through trees or bushes, particularly at this time of year, when those trees and bushes are covered in dew. And they don't have to worry about getting their fur damp. They don't have to make too much noise. And it essentially provides them with a very useful highway. And the elephants do it as well. Big herds of impala, giraffe, all of those animals will utilize the road network because they make their own in the bush anyway. They have their own game trails. So the roads is just an expansion of that. Oh, the wonderful news is that Brent has been continuing on his search for feathered creatures. Let's go and see which one he's got to add.
Well, we've come to the Buffalo's Hook waterhole, and there's the bullied three-banded plover. So if you were watching the sunset safari last night, there was a blacksmith lapwing bullying a poor little three-banded plover here. I can't see any lapwings, but we do have the three-banded plover. And all the other water birds are not up yet. I want to say good morning to Ephraim.
Morning.
Morning, Ev.
How are you?
Oh, can't you nice and cold. Any updates for your endow?
I heard the guy talking about the tandy, you know, the tandy disappeared.
It's disappeared.
Yeah,
okay.
Gone. But Lois is gone.
Yeah, she's gone. I'm gonna go check now, see if we can find any Nkonzo.
Ah,
Otherwise, it's very quiet. Just the Wanunangala and Gonzo are going north.
Yeah, I think I had to go to check there. With the Makoti, Fide, Ingwe, sorry, Fide, Joe.
Yeah.
Then from the Newton Gate. Hey, long way to go.
Yeah, long way. Good luck, Ev. Okay, morning meeting done. Chatting about the comings and goings of all the Wildebeests around. So apparently Tundi was seen very briefly on cheetah plains this morning and then disappeared. Tundi's quite good at disappearing. So is Queen Karula. And F's on his way to have a look at the dead elephant with hyenas and vultures on it at the moment. I wonder when those lions are going to spot all those vultures descending and go for an inspection. Oh, the arrow marked babbler's babbling now. But, oh, there's a chagra. Bottom. Oh, if it's gone. So, there we go. Now, I just wanted to double check. Is this the brown? Oh, it looked like it's a brown crown, so the one we've seen already. Okay. So, I wonder where Queen Karula has gone. Hopefully, she hasn't gone too far, and hopefully she hasn't gone to the south. Now, after that little bit of rain, we're starting to get back into proper dry season weather again. Crisp in the mornings, getting to sort of mid-70s during the day, and then dropping again in the evening. Now, I'm going to take Gwari Pan Road. I haven't taken Gwari Pan Road in quite some time. Maybe it'll have some special surprises in store for us. So let's work out. What did we work out we're on there now, Dave? Seven or eight?
Seven after the plover.
Only 43 more to go. So we're going to move through different parts of Juma. And as I said, we're not only looking for lions and leopards this morning, we're looking for birds as well. And as we move through the different bush types at Juma, we're going to look for different species in those different areas. You see them on their way to Buffalo's Hook. Oh dear. I don't think we're going to catch them. I will have to find some more somewhere else. There's some... Oh no, they've landed in the tree. Let's go have a look. They're having an argument. Or a discussion, because it's a pair. And they have quite animated discussions. They're coming overhead. There you go, it's the Egyptian goose. We were moving to see it and it suddenly decided it was going to come like a fighter jet over our heads. Yeah, well, there you go, Egyptian goose. And some grey go-away birds. Let's get some of the easier ones out of the way so we can concentrate on getting you guys some new bird species. Sunning themselves. We can hear the geese. Oh, whoops. You hear that, Dev? Yes. Keep your tea away from batteries, terminals. Just dust it carefully. Well,
very warm welcome to Dispatch, who only started watching yesterday. And Dispatch would like to know how many bird species are there normally at Juma. Well, there's lots. It's just getting them on camera is the challenge. So I would guess in total with vagrants and rare species that occasionally arrive, probably just under about, or around 350 for the greater Kruger area. So we only have a very small part of that. But some of our viewers' bird lists are on about 230, 240 at the moment that they've seen on camera. So that's incredible. There's quite a few safari guides be quite jealous of that number of birds. Okay, let's have a look. Nope. So we're going to move along Gwari Pan Road at the moment. Now, Gwari Pan runs along the edge of two little river systems, but it also has the mixed broad-leaved woodland, which holds different species. It's a good spot to bird because we're right on the cusp of two different preferential habitat zones. Where is that bird calling? Far away. So the most we've got recently on a morning is 25. We're hoping to smash that today. Hello, a blue butter frog would like to know, why do some birds vocalize when they are fighting and some birds don't? So a lot of those vocalizations are the same as a person shouting if they're fighting, so it's to scare them off and to try sound more dangerous than you are. But in certain cases, if the fight gets serious, you'll notice a lot of the vocalization stops, even if there are birds vocalizing. So it's a lot of posturing before the seriousness, and that's a lot of that noise. Also, that noise would be to attract females. There we go. In this little thing here, hopping around. And so zoom and down to where that grass is there at the base. Should a little bit to the left. And hold. It should pop out again now. I'm going to give a little alarm call to try speed it up. Psst, 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 psst. There we go. Oh, it's not being the most conspicuous, but it is a skulker. Oh, I didn't see what it was. I just saw it going, but it's another chagra. That's what he thinks of us, so that's what we think of you too, mister. So quite often when you're birding, you use funny little noises like that, which mimic the alarm calls of other birds. So they normally pop up to have a look if there's real danger around. So, psst, 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 psh, 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 psh. Ooh, what is that sitting up, sunning itself in the tree? And it is not a bird. It's a mammal. To the right. Back to the left. And zoom. A little bit to the left. There we go. Zoom again. Hello, monkeys. Top left front. There we go. Oh, look at that. Enjoying the morning sun. So in winter, you will often find vervet monkeys at the top of the tree, facing east, not doing much, but a little bit of grooming and some basking. Now, those aren't even grooming. They're literally dozing in the sunshine. It almost looks like they're fake monkeys that have been put there. That's so, so funny. I do love finding the monkeys when they're basking.
I don't think they've moved a muscle. I'm just going to move a little bit further forward, see if we can get a bit of a better view. Oh, is that one a bit closer? So they're the two in the back, but off to the left is that sitting and enjoying the sun. It almost looks like he's got his legs crossed. Half expect him to have a cup of coffee in his left hand. His eyes closed. Nah, they're open. Very, very cute. Right, we're going to leave the monkeys to enjoy their morning sunshine and keep on our endeavours. So, quarry pan is not producing too many birds. We're going to move through this area, and while we do that, let's go see how Jamie's search for the queen of Juma, Karula the leopard, is going.
The search for the queen is relatively unsuccessful at this point, but I will say that it's a very pretty search as we travel through the Mulwati drainage line. I figured, since her tracks haven't come out on either side, that she might still be somewhere in here. And so we're just slowly, slowly cruising along to check both for the queen and for her offspring. And we're going incredibly slowly, pretty much at walking speed at this point, because little leopard cubs are incredibly difficult to spot, even more so than their adult counterparts. Now we're trundling along, enjoying the bird song, enjoying the smells of the fresh river area, looking at the enormous trees. It's truly beautiful down here. And at the same time, looking for the giveaway flash of white of a leopard tail flicking somewhere in here. We might go through a bit of a tricky signal patch. Just give us 1 second. We should right ourselves relatively shortly. Try and speed up a bit through here. And the other thing we tried to do seems to be working absolutely fine. So the other thing we tried to do was check places where she has left her cubs before. Places where she's decided that it's a safe spot. Because I'm relatively certain in my own mind that she would reuse the same places, just like Shadow used to do with Sindile. She'd reuse the same places, but rotate between them, so as to allow the cubs a little bit of comfort. If they know an area, they know the big trees where they can escape if something happens while she's gone. It makes sense to me that she might put them in, she might have places in her own mind where she would go and hide them whenever she goes off hunting. That being said, she must have a very, very full belly, and as committed as she is to providing for her offspring, she might not need to go hunt just yet. She might want to find a nice spot somewhere in the sun to lie down and warm up and just generally enjoy a nice relaxed morning. Although that doesn't seem to be Karula's way. She kills, eats, and then goes straight into hunting again. I'm not sure I've ever seen her relax and bask in the same way we so often see Tingana or even Mvula doing. Karula's a busy girl and keeps herself very occupied. And Dispatch, who is one of our newest viewers, you wanted to know whether or not, because we were speaking yesterday about the fact that she is one of the most successful leopard mothers that I've ever heard of. Dispatch, my apologies, I didn't mean to give the impression that she was the subject specifically of a study into such things. What I merely meant was, in terms of leopard observations, and in terms of Look, she is one of the most well-known leopards in the world. Sorry, let's just duck under this archway quickly before I finish dispatch's question. World, she's very, very well known, and therefore very her history and background is very well documented. But if you throw her success rate, if you compare her success rate to the other leopards in the area, she stands out very far in front in terms of managing to raise successful litters from birth to adulthood and independence. So there's no specific study, just information that we have garnered from viewers who've been watching for many, many years, as well as some of the guides in this area who've also been working here for the entire duration of Karula's lifetime, or close to the entire duration of Karula's lifetime. That's what I meant when I said that she's highly successful. We know that most leopard cubs, or the statistics seem to suggest, that a leopard cub has a 70% mortality rate before its first year. And yet, Karula has done a marvelous job of, in her 12 years, raising nearly 5 litters. These little ones still have a little way to go before their survival chances increase. And she does it against the odds, which is what we respect so much about her. She's very, very good. And I mean, it might have been if you could dismiss it as something just because it's the area that she's in, but it's clearly not. Because if it were the area that she was in, then Shadow and Tundi and the other female leopards of this area would have equal success rates, which they definitely don't. Come on, little leopards, this is such a perfect place for mommy to have put you. So many big tamburti trees to climb up, or jackalberries, or leadwoods, secret hiding places. It's a beautiful spot. Brent and myself discussed this yesterday about the fact that probably this is our favorite place on Juma to just drive along through the Mawati drainage line. You don't even need to use your steering wheel. You just let the car carry you on our river cruise. And we're not far at all from where Karula gave birth to these cubs. And Trevor's been doing some in-depth wandering as we look at the beautiful trees, a stunning jackalberry in this morning light. While we go looking for our leopards, Trevor's wondering in a bit more detail what the Latin name for a leopard may be. And the answer to that is a Panthera pardus. So pardus is the panther sort of idea. Panthera, again, the panther sort of idea. But Panthera is the genus to which all, in which all roaring cats fall under. That includes tigers, lions, leopards, jaguars, and pumas as well. So all of the larger cats, not including a cheetah, because a cheetah is not a roaring cat. It's one of the unifying features of the Panthera genus. Tigers, we spoke about International Tiger Day yesterday. They fall under the list as well. Now, all in all, it is a very, very special genus, and the leopard falls under Panthera pardus, or pardus pardus, depending on how specific you want to be, because biologists are always arguing about species, subspecies, and the like. Okay, we've reached the end of our Mawati journey. Time to go out and search a little bit farther afield. Let's go search Batalia. It just occurred to me that this is where she hid the cubs when they were very first born. This was her chosen den site. So perhaps she's taken them back to the family home, or the initial family home. And incidentally, Trevor, that's where the name Panthera comes from. Obviously modeled on the genus of the big cats, and they specifically research into the big cats, whether they be tigers, snow leopards, leopards, lions, whatever they may be. And in fact, they actually contribute to the recording of data of the other endangered species as well, like wild dogs. But that is where the name Panthera comes from. Or that's where why the organization is called Panthera, and does a considerable amount of research, very valuable research, into the big cats of the world. also noticed a really serious, not serious, I don't mean serious in the way that we need to be worried, but a very noticeable, I don't want to say lack of animals because they're here. Brent for Jamie. Sorry, I didn't hear if those were male or female. Copy that, thank you. Brent has just picked up on some leopard tracks and they are heading in the direction that we're going in, so I wanted to just check with him whether they were male or female. They are in fact male, which does explain, well, potentially does explain, Karula's notable absence. She might have decided to remove herself from a male. I think generally, even though with the father, the potential father, we haven't seen Tingana around her much, I actually think she plays it better safe than sorry. Even though the dominant male leopard in this area is probably the father, or certainly will believe that he is the father, Karula does seem to play it safe with him and keeps her cubs out. It might just be coincidence that I've never seen them sharing a kill or seen them around each other. He's definitely followed her around at times because I've found his tracks on top of her tracks before, but she doesn't seem terribly keen on allowing him near potentially his kids. Perhaps that little extra degree of caution also accounts for her success rate. Shadow, on the other hand, has been seen with her little cub sharing a kill with Tingana a couple of times. So there's a notable difference there as well. And that being said, on our eastern boundary of Juma, the last place Sindile's tracking collar, the young male with the collar, the last place his tracking collar pinged was Torchwood, which is on our eastern boundary. And that's also a significant point. No sign of Karula here. Well, speaking of Brent's fresh leopard tracks, I kind of gave the game away, but I'm sure he wants to tell you a little bit more about them.
So we have found tracks of a male leopard, and they look very, very fresh. And they left the road back there, so I'm just checking through here quickly. A big male leopard, so it could be Tingana. Could be Gajima in this area as well. Now I just want to check up towards our eastern boundary. Now the road where we spotted those tracks is really hard. So we're checking on the next road along where the sand's a bit softer. Makes seeing the tracks a little bit easier. Come on, Dave, spot a leopard. There we go. He's got to remind the cameraman they've got to spot as well as use the camera from time to time. So of course, we're about to go through a bit of a staff changeover. So James will be back on Sunday. Viam and Kirsten are back today. And we have a new member of the team also joining us on Sunday as well. The name is Zander, and he will be a camera operator / editor on site. Okay. No! Naughty leopard! He's come out. He's gone that way there. But we are 20, 30 meters from the edge of our traverse. Let's go see, check up ahead. Are there tracks on your side there? Is that like cut across the corner? Let's just have a careful, careful look from around here. Oh, there we go. Is that tracks there, or is that hyena? That is a hyena. Abtech is wondering how many male leopards we have in this area. Now, Abtech, adult males, so in their prime or past their prime, we have within the Safari Live Traverse area, we have Tingana, Mvula, and Anderson. Now, those are the big adult males. And just below them is Mr. Shivambalan. Young males now, Quarantine, Sandile. And at the moment, that's it. So about six. And it can change. What is going on here? Ah, it's an elephant. I saw a drag mark, but it was an elephant dragging a stick. Okay, so I don't find any tracks coming out, so I'm going to go back to last track and have a closer look. Morning, John. John's wondering, how can we tell gender from tracks? Well, it's actually quite easy just based on the size. A male leopard like Tingana, his tracks are probably more than double the size of Karula's tracks. He weighs probably about 80 kilograms. Karula weighs 35. So size is the main way to tell the difference between the tracks. And I hear a squirrel shouting. Or is it me wanting to hear a squirrel shouting? I think it was me being wishful. Okay. Let me just double check carefully over here. Oh dear. Hyena. No, hyena. That's okay. Hyenas are allowed to go to the east. Leopards, not allowed to go to the east. Not that they ever listen to me, unfortunately. Okay, so I'm going to have a lot more careful, quick look on foot around here. Okay, I've got his tracks here. Okay, let's have a look. Okay, I'm going to have to go do some detective work to try to figure out where this leopard's gone. So while I put on my Sherlock Holmes hat, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
While Brent goes and investigates the clues of the footprints, we've come to ask our informants whether or not they've seen this leopard that Brent is tracking. So far, they are bearing their secrets well and keeping silent, but I have a suspicion that that cow on the right knows something. She definitely does, and that ram has got a very shifty look to his eyes. He knows where that leopard has gone, and it's just a matter of time before they tell us where it is. Right, all nonsense aside, we actually have a lovely collection of waterbuck and then a bachelor herd of impala all gathered together. This is the standard waterbuck herd that we see around Mumba Road, Drakensberg, pretty much every single day. And I think what would be quite nice is to actually do a head count of this particular herd. It's got a lot of little babies as well, and they're all looking extremely fluffy in the morning sunlight. I just thought I'd do a quick head count from left to right. Now there's two hidden there behind the tree. One, two, now three in that shot. Is it three? Yes, that's definitely three. There's number four munching away at the back. Five and six are the shifty looking ones. They know something. And here comes seven, eight hiding behind the trees, nine, two little ones supplementing the numbers, and then 10, 11, 12. Oh my goodness, there's a whole lot more. 13, 14. I've lost track. 15, 16, 17, 17, 18. 18 waterbuck in this herd. Here we go, some counting practice for Jamie on a Saturday morning. I'm just going to shuffle forward a little bit further so that we've got a nice view. Good morning, waterbuck. And five of the 18 are actually babies, which is quite impressive. They've done well to keep them alive. Actually, even more, six of them are babies. Tiny little fluffy creatures. The males are just starting to get their horns growing up through the tops of their skulls, which I always imagine, although of course I don't know, but I always imagine is a really itchy experience for the baby antelope. Just imagine that bone poking through the skin. This is not a male, this is a little female. In fact, I don't see any little males around us. Is it? Has it got horns coming up? No. And there's something wonderful about antelope babies this age. Look, it's the size of an impala. Just to give you a sense of scale, it's pretty much the exact size of the impala, but probably weighs a good 40-odd pounds more at the size that it is. Now, whilst it's the same height, waterbuck are not slender antelope in the same graceful way that impala are. They're slightly stockier. They're one of our largest antelope species that we see regularly. In fact, they are the largest in terms of weight, not in terms of height. The kudu takes that. But in terms of weight, and I'm talking just in this area, by the way, not in the entire Greater Kruger National Park area. There's a little male with his horns coming up through the top of his head at the back. Oh, you cute. Aha! Siberia Zumi has asked the question that I regularly answer, and then the answer goes straight out of my head, which is how many antelope could we see? Are we going to include the ones that we've never seen but that we could see? Maybe. Right, here we go. Steenbok, Dacre. Impala, let's try and do this by family. Impala, bushbuck, nyala, kudu, waterbuck, wildebeest. What am I? I've forgotten several, but I'm only counting the ones we regularly see. We've seen a reed book once. We have seen a reed book once. Jardre is right. And the sable's been on the dam camera, so that's 10. We could also potentially see tsetsebe, which is 11. We could see roan, which is 12. And we could see eland, which is 13. All of those are exceptionally unlikely. Oh, and Sharp's Graysbok, which makes it 14. All of those ones that I've listed at the end there are relatively unlikely to be seen. You probably won't see them here, but if we were to come across one of them, I can promise you now we would be unbelievably excited. Can you imagine if we saw a sable now on drive? It would eclipse everything. It would be absolutely wonderful. And I know they see them on Nkoro and Mala Mala. Now, one day it will happen. But you're beautiful too, waterbuck. Please don't take it personally. We have counted the reedbuck. We have counted the reedbuck. It was the one on Cheetah Plains with Sam. We've got that one. We've ticked that one off. And I know Brent has seen them a couple of times on Buffel's Hook as well, when he's been guiding for Vuyatela and Drummond up there. I'm sure I've forgotten one of the really obvious ones. Am I being completely silly? Dacre, Steenbok, Impala, Bushbuck, Nyala, Kudu, Waterbuck, Wildebeest. feel as though I've missed something out. But that is all I can think of. If 57 antelope species in Africa. I think it's around there. Just trying to remember now. Might even be larger than that. Lots of different antelope species. The waterbuck is the only member of this particular tribe, antelope tribe, that we get here in the Sabi Sand in the Great Kruger National Park area. If you go further towards Botswana, you will encounter a lechwe. And as I spoke about earlier, there was an article with a record of a lechwe and a waterbuck interbreeding. I'm not sure what you'd call the end result of that particular union. A lechbuck? Or a waterwe? Waterwe maybe is a nice name. That's something that has baffled people before. And also, you could actually potentially see Wildebeest, I think. I think there's a couple of them wandering around the Kruger National Park. We can add that to our list of antelope species as well. But for now, we will settle for our tatty waterbuck. I say tatty just because this one has got fly-bitten ears. Whenever you see an antelope with nicks and cuts in her ear like that, in a sort of a jagged pattern, that's almost invariably something that's been inflicted by the nibbling parts of the flies, because that's where the skin is at its thinnest. So they've nibbled away in the thin patch of ear, and then infection sets in and eats away at the outside of the ear. This cow, in contrast, doesn't seem to be too badly afflicted, and you'll probably find, probably, not necessarily, but probably, that she's younger than the other waterbuck cow. Because those are the sort of things that start to age, or start to impact on a waterbuck with age. We've never seen the waterbuck again that we saw on that wild dog chase morning with Gerrit in the back on camera, where we stopped and we had a waterbuck that was drenched in blood from her ear and the top of her head. I haven't seen her again, but that doesn't mean she isn't absolutely fine and well somewhere, but she was clearly a waterbuck that had a very fortunate escape. Our waterbuck cow has seen something. Now, most likely she's seen another antelope. She was just checking to make sure that all is well. And it absolutely is imperative that the waterbuck pay attention to whatever's going on around them. And while we've been sitting here, actually, I'm still looking to see what she's looking at. I don't think she's spotted anything urgent. Our waterbuck babies are getting braver and braver. Look at this. They're slowly coming up next to us, especially this little boy who's barely got any spikes at the top of his head. Isn't that cute? Did you hear the hippo? There's a hippo calling. There's a hippo calling not far from us. There's no water there. But yet there is a hippo calling. I'm going to go investigate. But while we play Sherlock Holmes on our side, let's go back to Brent for a quick update on how his, what would it be, following the evidence is going.
So we can just make out, well, not just, this is an incredibly clear track for where we are. Now, this leopard is running, and this ground is really hard. So this leopard's been seriously putting some effort into whatever it is. And if we look, there's some impala tracks around here taking off. So we're going to keep on playing the investigator, and I'm hoping that we're going to find this male leopard with a kill somewhere around here. So I'm going to have to be wandering around on foot for a while. So fingers crossed. And while we keep looking for the leopard, let's hope Jamie has some luck with her amphibious creature.
I just want to check something quickly while Brent goes and investigates, because I think I just might have driven over his tracks and I want to make sure I didn't, or he'll never forgive me. I will be in the dog's box for days if I've obliterated the tracks he's trying to follow. No, I think we're all good. I think we're absolutely fine. No, I'm racing off to investigate where this hippo is calling from. I want to find out, because as far as I know, the nearest water is Safari. Let me just check very carefully here. No. Brent's leopard hasn't popped out here. Right, so as far as I know, there's no water from here to our southern boundary. There is a big dam on the other side of the southern boundary on Chitwa. However, that sound didn't sound like it was coming from all the way there. And yet he was giving off the sort of standard territorial grunting of a big bull. Excuse me. Thank you very much. Right, we're trying to gauge exactly where it was. I think it came from Ledwood Road. And Jandre tells me that when he was sitting with Karula yesterday morning, he also heard this hippo calling. Makes me wonder if there isn't a little secret pan somewhere hidden in the bush that perhaps this hippo has decided to occupy for the moment while there's still groundwater. I mean, he could be all the way on the southern boundary, I suppose, but that's still quite far, and although it is cold this morning, the sound won't have travelled that far to sound as loud as it did. Now, of course, it's not unexpected to find hippopotamus out of water on this, in sort of days like today, where the temperature is low, because they've got to move about and try and maintain their body size and feed themselves during the drought. So without the sun being too strong, they'll actually spend as much time as possible feeding. I want to see where he is. Because it's actually something that we don't get to see as often as we would like to, which is a hippopotamus out of water. It's something that guests always ask for, and it's something that only really winter will provide. His tracks aren't here. Hippos also use the roads a lot, like the predators we were talking about. But it is something that guests very often ask for, and you've got to, in order to provide it for them, you have to go and sit at a dam as evening starts to fall to watch them come out. And it has to be winter, because in summer they'll actually often stay in the dam for a much longer time period. Where did the sound come from exactly? That's a very nice idea from Safari Hayes. And Safari Hayes is wondering if Pinchiwiner's hole in the rain, Pinchiwiner is a freshwater crab, whether or not he would have got any water filling up the hole that he lives in. I think that's a really nice idea to investigate, Safari Hayes. I see where Brent is. I hope I didn't drive over any tracks. I promise you I will be in so much trouble. I don't think I did, but the waterbuck might have walked over them first. That's my excuse and I'm sticking to it. No, I don't think I did. I would have spotted them, I'm sure. Where's this hippopotamus coming from? So Safari Hayes, I really like that idea. I think I might go and check up on the whereabouts of, or the situation at Pinchiwiner's home, which is in a hole, it's actually on the other side of the reserve from us right now. But if I find myself there, then I will definitely go and investigate and see whether or not it's got some water. Yes, I do think that the crab would have come out with all of that rainfall. I still haven't seen Pinchiwiner. I've seen the hole, but I haven't seen Pinchiwiner himself or herself. I don't think you could tell the difference between male and female crabs that easily. This also is a good spot for us to look for Karula, investigate whether or not she's around here. She might have decided to come back towards Leadwood Road. hippopotamus, though. The sound really didn't sound as if it's come from this far south. It's also quite useful in... It's actually quite... important to know as well if there's a secret little mud wallow that the hippopotamus is living in, because we've spent quite a lot of time tracking in that block, and there's nothing quite like a surprise hippo, particularly an uncomfortable surprise hippo that's feeling a bit nervous because it doesn't have its usual amount of water to protect it. Now, useful to know that there might be a hippo around us. Jerry says she doesn't know what a hippopotamus sounds like. She absolutely does know what a hippopotamus sounds like. I find that hard to believe. But I will do my extra best impression for her because I think that's what she's hinting for. And it goes... but much louder. It's not bad. That could be worse. Oh, Jerry. Jerry scored me a 10 out of 10 for that hippo impression. I'm not sure I would have given myself 10 out of 10, but I appreciate it. That means a lot coming from Jerry. She's quite a harsh scorer. She only gave me 4 out of 10 for my bracelet. I guess that hippopotamus must have come from... Just maybe stop and listen for a second. Perhaps the hippo will give us his best impression of a hippo noise. And we can actually just knock the car into neutral and roll down the hill. It's a bit awkwardly slow, though. Ah, God. It's too slow. It was just an awkward silence. Awkward silence and speed. Maybe if we get a bit of a run-up. That's better. Oh, whoops. Ren's trying to contact me on Game Drive Channel. My mistake. I was standing by Brent. South down Drakensberg and then along onto Cheetah Cut Line from Mumba. I didn't pick up on any Nkonzo, but there were Impala walking everywhere. Okay, copy. I'm going to drive Leadwood now. I'm just checking Gowrie Main, but I'll drive Leadwood and see whether the tracks come out there. I'm just chatting to Brent and planning our search mission since our hippopotamus has been a failure. I guess he's somewhere south, but I've just offered to help Brent out in terms of checking Leadwood Road to see whether or not I might have missed the tracks underneath the waterbuck and the Impala tracks somewhere on Drakensberg. Oh, we're really speeding now. We're flying down the road in neutral. This is quite fun. That was fun. Kathy? There we go. Kathy would like to know whether any of the animals have tracking devices. And the answer is yes, one does. So, there is a young male leopard that we call Sindile. And Sindile's story is a tragic tale, or almost was a tragic tale of woe, but actually wound up being a story with a seriously happy ending. Now, Sindile, when he was young, just learning to hunt, his mom disappeared off to mate with one of the other males for quite an extended period of time. She often left him all on his own. And in her absence, he wound up catching a domestic dog, or at least not a domestic dog, it was a stray dog that had come running in from the local villagers, and this later turned out the dog had rabies, and as a result Sindile was put in quarantine Here's some more informants for us while we talk about Sandile. Excuse me, have you seen a leopard go by? Sorry, Kathy, I'm distracted by the impala. So yes, the Sandile was put into quarantine for 8 months and given a series of vaccinations. Once he was declared rabies-free, he was released back into this area with a big collar wrapped around his neck. And that collar sends out GPS frequencies as well as a radio frequency, so he can either be followed by GPS points or he can be tracked down using telemetry once the GPS batteries start to run out. And he's being monitored by a very, very capable team and a gentleman called Jerry Camacho, who we have since met and who is an extraordinary man with a vast amount of knowledge. He's been monitoring the situation. And all in all, a happy ending for little Sandile, who seems to be surviving relatively well considering he spent 8 months out of the wild and being supplied with food and not practicing his hunting skills. He seems to be incredibly successful. It just goes to show how incredibly strong the instincts of these animals are. It's a very strong argument against nature rather than nurture for a leopard's hunting skills. Because Sandile has been absolutely fine. He's proved that he can catch things on his own, hoist things on his own. What happened in the interim, Kathy? What you can do, Kathy, if you would like to, and if you have a bent for social media, you can go and have a look at our special Safari Live story on this particular little leopard and what the story is behind his collar. There's some amazingly interesting information there. I think there's some more to follow. We'll of course be following up on this particular little big leopard now, for the rest of his foreseeable future, as long as he stays in the area. But go and have a look at the Safari Live story. It'll tell you all that you need to know about Sandile. And hopefully at some point soon we will... I'm wondering if Brent isn't tracking him right now. But, that being said, if it's a big male's tracks, then probably not. Sandile's tracks are still quite small. Now, Shamtan would like to know what made us think to check the dog for rabies and how did it get away from Sandile. Shamsun, almost inevitably a dog that runs into a reserve has got rabies. There is a big problem with, there was an enormous outbreak of rabies at the time in Hoedspruit and the surrounding areas. It had just wiped out an entire wild dog pack on the reserve that Brent's parents live on. Which is very incredibly sad. Oh, look, it's a still day come morning. Amazing. Ah. I spoke too soon. Damn. Oh well, it was definitely worth a try. Shamsun, so we already knew that it was likely to have rabies. It was almost inevitable because once the dog becomes rabid, unless the dog is rabid, they actually don't leave the comfort of the villages where they know they've got food, it's familiar to them, it's their territory. The stray dogs there, it's only if they get rabies that they become disoriented and confused and they make their way into game reserves itself. Unless you find a poacher's dog, which is also a possibility. How did the dog get away from Sandile? By the judicious addition of chasing it out of the tree. Chasing him and Sandile out. Sandile dropped the dog. And this was by the Sabi Sands authorities, by the way. It was with them there. The dog was a lot more alive than it gave the impression of being. It was sort of playing, obviously in its panicked, shocked state, it was playing dead. And as soon as Sandile jumped out of the tree, the dog fell out of the tree, got up and ran. And it was quite a long time before it was caught. It actually wandered right up to our camp that night. So a sad story and a very sad ending for the dog, but the dog was going to die anyway. The rabies would have set in and been far too advanced in order quite impossible to save once it gets to a certain point. But luckily, because it was tested and because that dog was taken to Pretoria, we were able in turn to save Sindile. Now, that being said, there is a lot of evidence to start to suggest that not all animals that are exposed, particularly leopards, and not all animals that are exposed to rabies necessarily contract it. There seems to be a degree of natural immunity to it. Not always, which meant that what happened with Sindile was absolutely necessary. And leopards do get rabies. It is a naturally occurring disease. But there does seem to be some evidence for a natural resistance. Legally, an animal that is exposed to rabies, proved to be exposed to rabies, is meant to be put down instantly, which was absolutely not what we wanted to happen in that case, and luckily was not what happened. Okay, no sign of our hippo and no sign of Brent's male leopard tracks, although this particular spot is difficult to follow up on. But I don't see any sign of them coming down this road. I think we should probably check Mamba Road and then be on our way. We've now, I think we've conclusively decided that Karula is not on the east. She didn't go east from that kill last night, and it doesn't look as though she went south. So she either went north or she went west, or she went northwest, because that's sort of the way that she might have gone. And perhaps towards Treehouse Dam will be our next port of call. And a warm welcome to James Black. James Black, I don't think I've ever heard your name on our safaris before. I don't know if that means you've been silently watching for a while, or if perhaps this is your first safari experience. If it is, we would like to extend a very warm welcome to you. It's wonderful to have you on board. Now, James Black is asking about our leopard behavior and whether or not they ever travel in groups. And the answer is no, hardly ever. Of all of the cats out here, big cats, they are the most solitary. The only time you will find them in a collection, what's a collective noun for a leopard? Help. A lump of leopards. Just because it's alliterative doesn't mean that it works. A lump of leopards. What about, I agree. I think this should be a challenge for all of you out there. Sorry, James. I will get back to your question in a moment. What would you call... Well, if you agree with Jandre, fair enough. If you want to call them a lump of leopards. A leap? Oh, it's a leap, isn't it? It's a leap of leopards. It's a leap of leopards. That's where you got lump from, Jandre. A leap of leopards. Oh, we could do better than that, couldn't we? We could definitely come up with a better collective noun for leopards. Anyway... James, the only time you'll find a leap of leopards is when they are mating. So you might even find not just a mating pair, you might find a jealous female waiting in the wings because there's another female in her territory, or you might find a jealous male mating in the wings who's hoping for an opportunity to join in. And then you will also only see them in a group when they have cubs. I find in my own mind, even when they're mating, they don't really seem very happy with the idea or find the idea of each other's company particularly enthralling. They mate because instinct says they have to, but they would quite happily be separate from each other the rest of the time. Now, leopards in this area are completely solitary, unless they have offspring. I have heard reports that is not necessarily the case in the Asian leopards. I don't know exactly how their social structure works. I've heard that you see groups of them together, which I find fascinating. I don't know much about it, and I'm not going to pretend to. Obviously, they've evolved a totally different structure, social structure. Where was it? It was somebody told me this. I'm trying to remember exactly where they were, that they used to see big groups of leopards together. It was Andrew. It was Andrew, the cameraman, that told me that he used to film leopards in groups. Where did he work again, Jandre? Was it Singapore? Where was it? In Sri Lanka. Oh, my goodness. It'll come back to me. It'll definitely come back to me. Somewhere where the leopards were the apex predators. So obviously somewhere without any tigers. And they were slightly more sociable. Female cheetah are also pretty much 100% solitary unless they have cubs with them. They tend to prefer not to have any company either. The males, on the other hand, are almost always in coalitions and far more successful if they have got company. A leap of leopards, okay, maybe leap is the best one. I can't think of a better collective noun, but if you can, you... And John has one suggestion for us, as to our collective noun, but I can't hear what his suggestion is. A larry of leopard. A larry of leopards. There we go, one suggestion, a larry of leopards. I thought initially that Jerry was saying lorry of leopards, which definitely sounds terrifying. Highly illegal. No lorries of leopards, please. Alright, I'm going to leave the area of our leopard, singular, and indeterminate collective noun. I'm going to leave our area so that Brent can do some serious tracking work. And I don't run any risks of driving over his tracks. And apparently, Brent is back off foot on the vehicle. Let us head across to Mr. Holmes and find out how his investigation is going.
Well, the detective mystery gets deeper. Like a true Sherlock Holmes mystery, we were following the leopard tracks. We lost the leopard tracks. The trail went dead. We happened to turn to our right and... What? There were lion tracks! It looks like a mating pair, male and female. You can actually see where they've mated. And they went this way. And if the leopard happened to bump into them, he could have gone anyway. So I just want to have a quick look up here to see if those lions came this way. I haven't heard anything while I was walking. Come on, kitty cats, but this is a true mystery. So, Dangerous Dish Watson, what do you think?
I reckon they're nearby.
Watson thinks, Watson the Dish thinks they're nearby. So we just want to check Hippo Pools Road, make sure those tracks don't cross into another one of these really big areas where we've got no roads, so fingers crossed they're still in this little block here. Okay, so we're going to go very slowly now. Hoping they're going to stay this side. We don't want them to go off to the right. So while we are looking here, let's have a little viewer poll. Now, out of everyone who's watching Safari Live this morning, let's see what animal that you guys think you would be the most scared of on foot if you had to walk into one of the animals, one of the wonderful creatures we have here on Safari Live? Which animal do you think you would be the most scared of? Send your answers to hashtag Safari Live on Twitter and or email us questions at wildearth.tv. Which animal would you be most scared to encounter on foot? Okay, come on, kitty cats. Come on, lions, make me look good. No. Is that a lion track crossing the road into the large wilderness area with no roads? It wasn't. It was a baby hippopotamus track, which is about the same size as a male lion paw print. Looks like they managed to sneak across here into this big block. Now I know Aubrey's checking on the other side, and of course that's not Aubrey who's asking about pygmy hippos, that's Aubrey the guide from Gallagher. So he's going to check that side, we're going to check back that way, check for that leopard, and there's only one road around there, so we don't want to put too many vehicles going in the same direction. So we'll let Orbs take on those tracks and we'll go back to looking for that male leopard. So Aubrey, not from Juma, would like to know, is there any chance of seeing a pygmy hippo? Not here. We can see a baby hippo, but that's still quite a bit bigger than a pygmy hippo. Pygmy hippos are a rainforest species and they only occur in a very, very small area, and they're very endangered. And the main, I think the last stronghold in the wild, if my memory is correct, is Liberia. And even then, extremely rare to see pygmy hippos. It's one of those sort of almost mythical beasts, like a carpi or a Congo peacock. Let us see if I can find a picture of a pygmy hippo. Hippo, hippo, hippo. My dad, when we were kids, one of his favorite things was to combine hippo and a crocodile, and a duck. So he used to ask us if we'd ever found a hippo crocoduck when we were out on the boat or out near a body of water. My photo is not working for some reason. I'll keep trying while we move along. I'll just say, there we go. Sierra Leone, Guinea, Ivory Coast, and Liberia. There we go, that's what I wanted to know. I knew Liberia was the stronghold of a pygmy hippo, and it's even a part of its Latin name, which is quite a mouthful. Choriorhopsis liberiensis. All right, let's go look for that leopard. Okay, well, hopefully Aubrey has some luck with those lions. I'll keep my ears open. So I just asked, what are you most scared of to encounter on foot in the African bush? Mary says, spiders! Now, Mary, out of all the wonderful, big, hairy, scary creatures we have out in the bush, I think the one that poses you one of the least threats is a spider. In my many, many years in the bush, since I was about 4, and even before that we were on a farm, I've never been bitten by a spider. I've been bitten by lots of mosquitoes, ticks, tsetse flies, filaria flies, giant elephantine horse flies. What else have I been bitten by? Hornbills, geckos, lots of different birds have bitten me. I'm trying to think what else. I've been bitten by one snake, non-venomous of course, but in all those years I've never been bitten by a spider. But I have, strangely enough, been headbutted by an animal. I've actually been headbutted by a few animals, but one of the animals that's headbutted me, Jamie has got on the other vehicle. So let's go have a look.
Funnily enough, my brother was also headbutted by a warthog once when he was very small, and as a result harbored a deep fear of warthog. Oh, photobomb. Nyala. Hello, Nyala. You're not happy with us paying attention to the slightly uglier animals that are behind you? She's very casually just blocked them from our view. I'd like to finish the warthog story, though, because it's actually quite entertaining. My brother was little. My dad went on, I think it was a medical conference in a place called Warm Baths. It's no longer called Warm Baths. It's called Bella Bella, known for its hot springs just outside of Pretoria. And Angus was still in nappies at this point, and I remember it vividly because there's an 8-year age gap between the two of us. And he was wandering around and busy looking at the warthogs, and one of the babies snuck up behind him and threw him into the air. And we picked him up in the sort of style of South African child rearing and patted him on the head and said, "You're fine. Don't worry, you're not hurt. It's all good. You're quite there, okay." And he started tottering back to the house, and he got thrown into the air again. And I mean, he really was thrown into the air. And he cannot possibly remember that. He is so young. Well, we thought he would never remember that, but he did. And we went to the Kruger National Park a couple of years later, stopped off at the camp, one of the camps, to get the entrance ticket and pay for our entrance. And he was desperately shouting at us at this point, probably about 5 years old, to please roll up the window because there were warthogs outside the car. I'm not sure if he's ever managed to deal with his fear of warthogs, but that obviously traumatized him deeply. The headbutt from the warthog. A story that we downed out upon for many, many years because it was thoroughly entertaining. Poor child. He's fine, by the way. He's managed to reach adulthood, all in one piece, but with a slight minor fear of warthogs and spiders and all things creepy crawly. Bye-bye, warthogs. It was nice to get to see you. Thank you for sticking around for as long as you did, despite being overshadowed. Tails in the air. Sort of minor alarm, but nothing too serious. And the warthog in this area are often relatively skittish. Our photobombing and Nyala have also managed to disappear off into the vegetation. We haven't got the clearest view of them. Also, incredibly useful informants in the bush when you're conducting an investigation into where your leopard has disappeared to, because they will be the first to let you know if it goes wandering through an area with their deep booming barks. I haven't heard any of those this morning. It makes me think the leopard has not come in this direction, either Karula or the male that Brent has been following up upon. That's my favourite so far from Iritis. I really, really like that as a collective noun for leopards. A lottery of leopards, because you get really lucky when you find them. I like that. A lottery of leopards. I hope we win the lottery today. It's a race between Brent and myself as to who wins the lottery. But once we find one, then everybody wins. So a lottery of leopards. I like that. That's my favorite. I'm going to call them... I think that's better than a leap of leopards. A lottery of leopards. Let's go and win the lottery. I'm feeling lucky today. One thing that I have not seen any sign of, any fresh dung, any tracks, which is totally bizarre. I would love to know where they've all gone and how it is decided that this is what happens. I have not seen one elephant track, one fresh elephant track or pile of dung. How do they decide when? Because it feels as though we either have all the elephants in the area wandering around or we have none of them. I would really love to know how that gets decided upon. What makes them move where they go? Food, of course, and water, but plenty of water and, I mean, the same amount of food as anywhere else. Obviously some inbuilt mechanism so that don't overutilize an area. Okay, and so we find ourselves back where we have started, an unsuccessful search for female leopard tracks. And hopefully we didn't miss those male tracks coming across. The only place we would have missed them was with those waterbuck and impala, just because there were impala tracks everywhere on the road that might have obscured them. And so we turn our attentions and our eyes to the western horizon and start heading across in that direction. Let's begin our search in this area by checking all of the favorite spots where Karula used to hide her cubs. Standing by. I'm going to do elephant skull to treehouse. Brent, I might have missed those tracks with where I stopped for the waterbuck and impala on Drakensberg, just because there were so many impala tracks on the road. Copy, I did do Mumba Road, but it might be worth double checking. One of Karula's favorite spots to leave the cubs is in this drainage line system. This is where Jandre and myself found them a couple of weeks ago, when they were having an absolutely marvelous time dashing up and down the wall of the drainage system, on the river system. Definitely one of my best, in fact, still to date, my best leopard sighting. It was absolutely incredible. And Jandre and myself both drove away at the end of that morning with enormous smiles plastered across our faces. And welcome to Eve, who is a brand new viewer. And Eve says that she's too nervous to ask questions, but that she is happy to watch and enjoy. Eve, whatever makes you happy, I'm thrilled that we have you on board and that you're enjoying the safari experience. Please, please don't feel shy to ask questions though. If there's something burning in the back of your mind that you've always wanted to know about, we definitely will be more than happy to answer it. There is no such thing as a stupid question. And don't forget, Eve, that there are probably lots of new viewers in a similar situation. Because, of course, a lot of our viewers have been watching for years and years, and they have come to know and understand most of the things and facts about the various animals in this area. That doesn't mean that we don't get new viewers who are in exactly the same boat and are a bit too shy. They don't want to seem like they're asking a silly question. But I promise you there isn't a silly question that has been asked. And some of the questions that viewers have sent through to me have actually either directly or indirectly expanded my knowledge tremendously. It's how we learn, ask questions of each other. And you'll probably find that no matter how long I've been working in the bush or how long viewers have been watching, there is a question that occurs to you that none of us have ever asked ourselves before. It was a wonderful one the other day. I'm trying to think of the example. Something that I'd never ever thought about. It was a brilliant question and now I can't remember it. Oh my goodness. It'll come back to me, Eve. I commented at the time that I was surprised that I'd never thought to ask that question myself. It will come back to me along with the viewer that asked it. Probably at sort of 3 o'clock this morning when I sit up bolt upright in bed and remember. be careful when you're checking for leopard cubs. They are so secretive. But Jandre raised a good point that we have our best chance early in the morning because it's when they are at their most playful. Movement might just attract our eyes to them. Oh, Jandre, I really want to get this bird. It's one of my favorites. It's hopping about. I can see it. You got him. It's one of my favorite birds because look how ridiculous its bottom looks without any tail. It's called a long-billed crombeck and it's definitely one of the cutest tiny little birds. Oh, well done, Jandre. That was awesome. We managed to get close enough to see it. The crombeck family have exceptionally reduced tails. I don't know why that might be, perhaps just in terms of the vegetation that they live in. Perhaps a long tail gets in their way since they spend, as you saw, most of their time hopping around on the branches. Now we can add that to our collection of feathered creatures. Let's go across to Brent now while we continue our search for Karula and find out what his plans are for following up on that leopard.
So we have abandoned those male leopard tracks as that we play the lottery. Now Sherlock would be disappointed in me, but I am going for what I would consider a slightly more sure thing, looking for Karula and those cubs. Big bellies, probably haven't moved too far, but with the queen, you never know. There's no tracks of her heading outside of our traverse zone. So I'm thinking, if I was Queen Karula, where would I go? Where would I put my little darlings to be safe? If we don't find any tracks in this area, I think I know where to check next. Let's see, are there any tracks? George Anne and Anita say they'd be most scared to encounter a buffalo on foot. And Joey says hippo. Now, I think for me, personally, and remember, it depends on the area. I would say hippo is definitely high up on my list of things to be careful of. They're a bit faster than a buffalo, so definitely be high up on mine, but it also depends on the area. So I think the hippo of southern Tanzania are the most scary because those rivers literally become centimeters deep during the dry season and there's very few spots for hippo to hide. So literally under every bush almost during the end of the dry season there are hippo sleeping. Karula's kill wasn't too far from here in the Mwati, so I think she might have gone south. Hi Ellen. Ellen in Arkansas said she'd be most scared of wild dogs. Ellen, that's so sad. They're so nice on foot. I've laid down in the road and I've had one sniff my camera lens that it's actually misted the lens up that I couldn't even take a photo. There's never been a recorded case of wild dogs attacking a human being on foot. And a few months ago, Andrew and James had that incredible
sighting of wild dogs on bushwalk. So I think we're going to check Ingwe Alley. I think that's a good spot to look for the queen and cubs. Birds have been a bit quiet this morning, so maybe while we check around for Queen Carilla, we might find the odd feathered creature. I can hear a white-browed scrub robin calling. So we're now pretty much directly opposite where Carilla's kill was. So if she was going south, she would have gone straight south here. Yeah. Beyond that. Oh, he's a little bit lower. There he is. Southern black tit. And sorry, Georgianne. The bird had distracted me. Georgianne would like to know, is it true that most of the bird species found in the Greater Kruger are not going to be seen in the Sabi Sands? That is not true, Georgianne. The majority of the species will be throughout, because we are part of the Greater Kruger. There's certain area specials that you won't find in the Sabi Sands, and there's certain birds in the southern Sabi Sands you're not going to find in the northern Sabi Sands. That's due to the terrain. So where you've got big rivers, obviously you've got more water birds. Yay! Is it flowering? Our only winter flowering plant that hasn't really been flowering because of the lack of rain. And let's have a look. It's a very sick looking calantia. Oh, didn't flower. It tried, but it didn't succeed. So you can see how withered, and this is a succulent. That's how dry it is at the moment. Shame. Maybe next year. This rainy season will be better. It's a narrow-leaved calantia, that's the name of that plant, and we had some beautiful specimens flowering during last winter. Now, quite exciting, well, for me anyway, and for Jamie, I suppose, is that I have an impala lily, and it's about to flower, and they're very, very beautiful flowers on the impala lily. Lucy's wondering about the one sausage tree on Juma and what it looks like, and has it been affected by the drought? Well, Lucy, the sausage tree is not too far from us, so I'll go take a swing past it. But it probably has. I've never personally seen sausages on that sausage tree. Half expect to see Queen Carilla and the cubs are lounging, but instead of a spotted animal, we've got a striped one. Nice herd of zebra. Two foals in it. Wagging, wagging tail. The zebras don't look like they're losing too much condition just yet. But a zebra is always quite a difficult animal to tell whether it's in bad condition because of their digestive system. So they're always very rotund and flatulent. Oof, oof. Oh, naughty, you got into trouble. Zebras are also quite violent animals, although you wouldn't expect it. And it's not uncommon for foals to be killed by stallions. And they have a harem social system. It's a dominant male who keeps a group of females. But even within those females, there is a hierarchy. And the female, the oldest, most experienced female, when the zebras are not doing what they're doing now, which is just spreading out feeding, but when they are moving somewhere and in a straight line, the oldest, most experienced female takes the front and the male takes the back. And if it's incredible, if any zebra is out of position, so if a young female starts leading or straying or whatnot, the stallion will run from the back and bite her and kick her back into her rightful spot in that line. Well, they're disappearing into the bushes. Something we're seeing quite often at the moment. Oh, he's going to walk down just because I said that. Oh, off it goes. But there was a zebra on top of this termite mound, and the zebras are taking advantage of what little grass is left, and the termite mounds is one of the spots that have grass. It's chorus grass, and it's not the tastiest grass, but it is a drought, so you've got to take what you can get. Just quickly, because it's right in front of us. Probably one of our most common bird species, a Cape turtle dove. Hello, little dove. Enjoying the sun? Okay, so we're going to keep checking. I've got a feeling Karula's down here somewhere in this little river system, and I'm going on gut at the moment. So while we follow my gut, let's go back to the head-butting creatures.
Seems to be a warthog-themed morning. And both of them have decided to put themselves in a very inconvenient position, so bear with me, I'm just going to shuffle forward ever so slightly in the hope that it improves our view. I think, by the way, that Brent's gut feel is spot on. And that seems to be supported by the lack of tracks popping out anywhere east, west, or south. Ooh. Yeah, that's definitely a little bit better. Now we've got two warthogs, the female on the left, and I think it's a male on the right. I haven't had a chance to properly check. The difference between them two, those two, of course, is the size and the number of warts that they have on their face. Is that mud that she's still got under her eye, or has she got a really runny eye? Not quite sure. Might have been rubbing preorbital glands to create those dark streaks down her face. So she's got two warts just below her eyes. The male has four. And they are usually far more prominent. They're not, of course, warts. They are basically pieces of grizzle that they can utilize in protecting themselves and protecting their most vulnerable parts when they fight with each other. Nope. This is a young female. Much younger female. Her tusks still haven't properly started to come through just yet. And obviously there's something nice worth snuffling over there where the warthog on the right is. Something in the mud. This is right next to some of the nicest pans. We refer to pans as sort of muddy wallows that the animals frequent. There's quite a few pans in this area because it's part of a natural seep line. There's lots of water here still, particularly after the rain, and it will retain that underground moisture for much, much longer. I'm curious about those streaks. I do wonder whether or not her eyes have been watering. Lots of dust, so it does make sense. Hello, girl. What's up? Another animal. I know you've been talking about animals that we fear most when we go out on foot, all of us around the world. Warthog is not an animal I fear on foot, but it's definitely an animal that's given me the most frights, or one of the animals that's given me the most frights on foot. An explosion of warthogs out of a burrow is quite an interesting experience. Fortunately, haven't yet managed to fall foul of one. My dog Lexi loved to play with them, which was utterly terrifying in the beginning when she was little. She's bigger now, and she's learnt, and she's calmed down, but when she was a puppy, and she was about the same height as a warthog, but probably about a third of its weight, she used to go running up to them and sort of try and engage them in a game, which was very dangerous, because dogs do get out here, can get killed by warthogs. And once she came sprinting round the corner with her tail between her legs, straight behind me, with a warthog in serious hot pursuit. And after that, Lexi learned not to play with warthogs anymore. They don't want to be her friend. The Inyala, however, she still has a lovely game with. Not often we get to spend this amount, or at least it didn't used to be often that we spent this amount of time with warthogs. With their thick mane of hair running down their backs, luxurious blonde manes that serve to sort of stand up on end whenever they get a fright and make them look about twice the size that they actually are. It's interesting how some leopards are much more skilled at tackling and killing warthogs than others. It seems to be Tingana's special skill. It's going into tunnels and plucking out baby warthogs. I say his special skill. We've seen him do it twice. That's still more than I've seen any other leopard do it. He's also apparently renowned for killing aardvark. So tunneling animals is Tingana's speciality. Dacre, Impala and Steenbok seem to be Karulas. And then you get some leopards that have learnt to survive off scavenging as well. Alright, I think that thick tree spells the end of our warthog sighting. Let us carry on and see what else we can find. I'm going to check in as we start heading to the west with the guides at Arethusa to see what's been found there. Hello, warties. You're on your way. And stop to let the locals cross. Here you go, girl. There's one, and then there goes two. Very dainty animals. And since we know exactly where they crossed, let's see what the sand's like. We might be able to get a nice view of their track. Hey, girl. I'm not going anywhere just yet. That's okay. Well, now we've got the warthog right out in the open, we can sit with them for a little bit until she disappears. This is also one of my favourite spots in summer. In winter, it's a bit drab, but in summer, it's really beautiful. Wonder if there's any mud in that wallow. Oh no. Their tracks are going to be impossible for me to show you, unfortunately. Very, very thick sand. I mean, very hard sand. There's some mud there. And some of this place is teeming with buffalo bulls that come through to these muddy sections to wallow about and spend their afternoons in luxury, the equivalent of a spa treatment. But for now it looks as though there's also some water there, and Warthog looks as though it's drinking. It's all right. Little unsettled head bob there. Going down to drink, but not wanting to take her eyes off us. Ah, oh, there's definitely some really thick mud there. She's now got muddy socks. It's okay, girl. We're far away. We're not going to do anything. There you go. Much less relaxed than her daughter. Most likely is her daughter. Okay. Let's leave our Warthog so that she can have a drink and doesn't feel too scared by our presence. To relax enough to pop her snout down into that watering hole. We'll leave her be. So Karula hasn't popped out where I was hoping she might, which I think reaffirms Brent's gut feel that she's somewhere around that drainage line, Ingwe Alley, perhaps Twin Dams, somewhere that side. She obviously didn't go too far last night after she finished that kill. As an interesting aside, I found a set of leopard tracks that look like a young male to me. Not 100% sure, and I'm also not convinced of their freshness. I would say they were from yesterday. Which means that following up on them is going to be very difficult. But it also, if it is a young male, and immediately, of course, our minds jump to the idea of Sindile. He was in Hoffman's. From what we could see from Harry's update, he was in Hoffman's, and he must have got to Torchwood somehow. He probably walked through Juma, so perhaps that's how he did it. Perhaps he walked along the Treehouse Dam Road. They definitely didn't look fresh enough for me to go bounding out of my car and racing off into the bush to try and find him. But it is interesting. It's definitely an animal that Karula will want to keep her babies away from. Even though he is her grandson, I mentioned that Warthog was, or could well have been, that female's daughter, and that's led Michael to ask, will the females stay with their mothers for the rest of their lives, or will they eventually separate? And Michael, chances are they will at some point separate, but they can stay with their moms for quite an extended period of time. So Warthogs form little sounders, and quite often the females in those sounders, in those little groups, are related to each other in some way, often a mother-daughter or a set of sisters, a pair of sisters that have linked together, and it most likely won't last throughout their entire lives. The daughter will probably separate at some point, but there is a chance. I mean, especially with that female, she was quite young still. I don't think she's much older than, or she's approaching a year maybe. She's still very young, so she's young enough to stay with her mom for now, but she's completely weaned. When she comes into estrus, and the warthog breeding season is around the same time as impala breeding season next year, when she comes into estrus next year, she might get separated from her mom, move off on her own, find a mating opportunity, or alternatively, she will just stay with her mom and have her mom's help in raising the little ones. So whilst they don't allosuckle each other's offspring, as far as we know, you never know, but as far as we know, they don't allosuckle each other's offspring. Ooh, honey badger tracks, but they're not very clear. I won't be able to show you these properly, unfortunately. I'm going to race through to the west and hop onto the Game Drive channel, find out what exciting things are happening on that side. While I do that, let's go back across to Brent for an update on his plans for the rest of the morning safari.
So there's no sign of Krula coming out in the south, so maybe she's still between Batalea Road and the Mawati, sleeping off that belly full of impala. As I made my way towards quarantine, there were apparently some lion tracks heading this way. So go have a quick look around there and just have a general peruse, see what's about on quarantine. Warming up quite nicely, not quite ready to take off the layers yet, unlike Dangerous Dave, Dangerous Dish. We've decided to drop the Dave. He was flexing his biceps in his tight shirt because he's really tough, so he can face the cold weather. Oh, there we go, pretty bird. Just okay there. I think is that just come out a bit. Oh, am I lost? Oh, I'm blind. It must be there. Just up a bit. There he is, hiding in the shadows. Lilac-breasted roller. One of the roller families of quarantine, we've got the lilac-breasteds, and we've got purple rollers that we see often on quarantine as well. We've actually seen them battle for perching spots before. Now I hear some oxpeckers up ahead, which generally means there must be a mammal. So I can hear the oxpeckers. And what are they sitting on? Are they sitting on a buffalo? Are they sitting on a giraffe? No, they are sitting on a kudu. I could just hear the oxpeckers. And there's some kudu in the little river system. Oh, off the kudu goes with the oxpeckers into the depth of a little drainage system. So while our antelopes disappeared into the Tambuti thicket, Jamie's got some that are hopefully being a little bit more photogenic.
Well, a little bit more confiding. We have a female stembok that is very much hidden behind this fallen bush willow. And she seems to be adopting the approach of she's a tree, she's a tree, she's a tree. She does have, or she did, when we came through here, a really, not tiny, tiny baby. Oh, I can still see it. Actually, little one is a bit more nervous. It's straight through where that apple leaf, oh, there it goes. Tiny baby. not newborn, but only a couple of months old, and about half the size of the female. Unfortunately, it's a lot more shy than she is. And she's not exactly standing out in the open either. Let us try and reposition, so we can get a better view of her. I hope she'll stay. Hey, girl. Slowly, slowly forward. It's as soon as you stop. They don't mind it when you're moving past them. It's as soon as you stop that they realize that you're looking at them. Thank you, girl. Quite a nice, relaxed little steenbok. Not often that we get to enjoy them. So in contrast to the dekker that we've been seeing earlier, a much redder color to the antelope, it's also got a little bit of a black strip, but not nearly as pronounced on the top of its nose, and its ears are much larger than that of a dekker. Big wide eyes, very large ears, and perfect tan and white, whereas a dekker is a little bit more uniform in terms of its grey colour. I love the inside of steenbok's ears. It's one of my favourite parts about them. They almost look like they've got a pattern of veins running through, which of course they do underneath that fur. Little girl. And this is the standard steenbok defence, which is to freeze and to sum up the issue, or to sum up the situation that she finds herself in before deciding whether to run or to hide. And what they'll usually do is they'll run a little bit and then stop and freeze. And off she goes. Beautiful. It's the same color as an impala. Really very pretty. And of course, steenbok, it's basically the brick antelope. That comes from the red, the color of the red on the coat. Little baby's still there. For now. I can see where Mom went, but she's completely obscured. But there's the little one. You can see its tail's not quite as fluffy. And as I said, although it's difficult for you to get a sense of scale, it's probably about half the size of Mom. Comes up to about my knee. Very brave decision there from Jean-Ray to try and follow the shrike that came screeching past us over our heads. It was a southern white-crowned shrike, but unfortunately, well done, Jean-Ray. Most impressive. He managed to stay with it. Our little steenbok took the opportunity to go bouncing off into the bushes. And a question from one of my favorite usernames, which is Fuzzman Sparkles. Good morning, Fuzzman Sparkles. It's great to have you on board and hear your questions as always. Fuzzman Sparkles would like to know if I've ever seen or we've ever seen a steenbok and a dekker together. Yes, a lot. Often find them together in exactly the same habitat. It's an interesting thing, the steenbok and the dekker, two distinct species that have evolved to occupy essentially the exact same ecological niche. They feed off the same, almost the same foods. We discussed that perhaps the dekker has a slightly more omnivorous bent to its diet, but not really. The shoots and the leaves and whatever else they can find in an area, they're exactly the same in terms of their social structure, living in monogamous pairs, that they mate for life. Territorial against other members of the species, but not against a steenbok versus a dekker or vice versa, if you know what I mean. That's quite a fascinating thing about the way that dekker and steenbok have evolved. And graysbok to an extent, although they're more sort of in the rockier areas and with a little bit more competition from klipspringer, which is an antelope that you might see out here. There's apparently one on Simbombili that I've never seen, but apparently there is one that lives on Simbombili. A clip springer is a little antelope that is perfect, dances right on its tiptoes, stands right on its tiptoes, and is adapted for, as the name suggests, for those of you who understand Afrikaans, clip springer, rock jumper, adapted for jumping around on rocks and cliff faces. Goodness gracious me. It is the day of the steenbok. Steenbok and Dekker Day. In this case, a little male. Bounce, 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 bounce. I love watching them do that. There's so much agility and speed. I've been listening to the Arethusa Game Drive channel, by the way, for the past half an hour. All seems to be relatively quiet on that side as well. Our animals have gone into hiding. And that steenbok, by the way, even though we travelled a relatively short distance there, that is probably in a separate steenbok territory to the one, the female that we saw earlier. So that's most likely not her partner. It is most likely a neighbour. And the interesting thing about little steenbok and Dekker, some of them are entirely faithful to their partners throughout their lives. Others are slightly less so. So a steenbok female will be territorial against other females, a male will be territorial against other males. But if a steenbok male or female happens to run into a member of the opposite sex on their boundary, then they might decide to have a little dalliance in order to keep the genetics fresh of their offspring. So they're very tolerant of, but they will only, that being said, whilst they will mate with a neighbor or a nomadic little creature, they will only rest and forage with their mate. Also always a good idea here to check here for shadow. And Dispatch, welcome once again. Dispatch is a new viewer and has been watching for, I think, only a couple of shows. And Dispatch wants to know how you spell the name of the species. And I imagine that that is steenbok that you are asking about. So you spell it S-T-E-E-N-B-O-K. Steenbok. And the book, of course, is the Afrikaans version of buck. B-U-C-K, but it's B-O-K in Afrikaans. Oh, there's a place we will not be going. To protect our camera from the dust that is flying up. So what this gentleman is doing as he races towards us and we have to escape him is dragging the road. He is smoothing out the road. He's got tires tied behind the back of the truck or the tractor, called a gunda gunda in Zulu, which is one of my favorite words, because it's so descriptive of the sound that they make. So while I race away from our tractor that is bearing down on us with much speed and much dust, let's go back across to Brent, who has found the tallest animal out here.
There we go, we can see a giraffe's nostril through the timberti tree. Quite interesting, when we arrived that giraffe was feeding off the timberti tree, and a timberti tree is quite noxious, poisonous, and the reason certain animal species will feed off a tree like a timberti is if they have stomach parasites, that poison will go through to their system and purge it. So the giraffe is self-medicating. Not quite to the same degree as humans self-medicate, but the era of the TV doctor has caused much self-medication and bred a few hypochondriacs, or actually lots of hypochondriacs. Now, Justin's wondering, how much water will a giraffe drink in one day? Oh, Justin, I would be lying if I knew exactly, but I would guess probably 5 or 6 liters. They don't need to drink every day, but possibly 5 or 6 liters a day on average would be my guess. Giraffe, you're not being very, very nice to us. It's a very difficult spot you're sitting in. Now, this is another big male giraffe. That giraffe, different from the giraffe we saw early this morning. We're quite far from that area. Gerald, just watching us. Let's see if I go forward, we can maybe get a better view through a gap. And final control, I think they're being very funny at the moment. As I said, Gerald, as in Gerald the giraffe, not Gerald the Geraldine. A slightly better view. Oh, at least we can see the lovely long lashes of a giraffe. They have incredibly long eyelashes, and that's a bit of protection against thorns. Oh, that's an interesting name. The Tech would like to know, is there an evolutionary purpose for giraffe horns? Oh, he's got a floppy ear as well. Of course there is. It is for fighting. They use their horns as battering rams to beat other giraffe into submission for the rights to mate. And the proper word for giraffe horns is an ossicone. So unlike a lot of the other horned creatures we get here, they lack the keratin or hair, hardened hair covering, and they just have skin and hair. Now, a male giraffe is bald on top of his horns, and a female will have lovely tufts of hair. Can we get into the eye there, please, Dov? Now, we can't... There we go, turn sideways. There we go. You can see those long eyelashes there. So, if their eye gets too close to a thorn or something, those eyelashes will touch it first, causing them to blink. So, the long eyelashes to protect the giraffe. Now, you can see he's quite old. He's been in the wars. Those bumps on his nose are probably from fighting. And even that injury to his ear could easily be from battling with another giant for supremacy over ladies. They are quite strange creatures. They like to watch everything that's going on. So you can see he's just checking us out, trying to decide whether we warrant closer inspection or not. Gerald? Now they have an incredibly long tongue. I think it's about 9 inches long. Oh, sorry, 9 inches, am I? They have incredible evolutionary adaptations to have that incredibly long neck. Now, a lot of people think that long neck is specifically for getting to those high branches. But from an evolutionary point of view, it's actually more to do with fighting. So the longer the neck, the longer you can swing, or the harder you can swing, I suppose, basic physics. But old Gerald is a very, very big animal. Males can weigh up to about 4,000 pounds, 4,250 pounds, so nearly 2 tons. And the biggest female, even a female can be very big, and about 2,600 pounds, but they're obviously quite a big difference. Sorry, and then the tongue of the giraffe is an incredible adaptation, and I was incorrect. My brain was having a holiday. It's 20 inches long, about 50 centimeters, and it's prehensile, so they can use it to wrap around and grab things. So it's an incredible, incredible piece of anatomy. Well, Siberia, Zumi is wondering about a recorded height on giraffe, and a big male can be as tall as 6 meters, which is about 20 foot. So that's a really, really tall giraffe, but I don't know of any particular standout record giraffe that was much taller than that. Hi, Shannon. Shannon's in Ohio, and Shannon's wondering, what does a giraffe's fur feel like? Well, Shannon, it's quite coarse, like most animals out here, so it's not nearly as sort of soft and fluffy as you would like it to be. Very, very coarse. Of course, they've got to walk through lots of thorns and trees and bushes, so it has to be quite coarse, and their skin is quite thick. And you can see those wonderful patterns on the giraffe help it with camouflage to break up the outlines. And in different parts of Africa, you have different patterns of that. And I know quite a few of you have seen this image before. And I unfortunately forgot my iPad this morning, so it's a bit small. How's that, Dave? So there we go. So that's our giraffe down at the bottom. Oh, don't touch things. Stop being misbehaving. So that's our giraffe down at the bottom. So the Angolan and Southern giraffe have very similar patterns. And then as you move further north, one of my favorites is definitely the Maasai giraffe pattern. And then we have the Roths, the reticulated, sorry. That's also a very, very cool one up in East Africa. And then the Rothschild. And then the sort of general between all of them is actually the West African giraffe, which is up top. But we were talking about patterns, Gerald has decided he's out of here and he started moving away from us. Okay, Gerald, we'll see you later. Now, guys, keep a close look on the Juma dam cam, because I think Gerald is going to head that way, and after drive, he might be there quenching his thirst. Oh, apparently Gerald has already quenched his thirst at the dam. So, well, he's still in that general area. So the lions have disappeared. Is that a lion track there, Dave? It's an old lion track, I'm afraid. But they were around here, the last tracks going into this area. That very difficult area where we can't get a vehicle, unfortunately. The kitty cats today. Now, Saturday Cat Day is being a bit quiet on the cat front today, but hopefully it heats up in the afternoon. Now, Jamie McCarthy, speaking of cats. Jamie McCarthy says she'd be most scared to walk into lions on foot. Now, during the day, Jamie, lions are actually not a problem. 99% of the time, they run away from you. At night, however, it's a different story. They become dominant. At night, they'll just eat you. But during the day, most often, they will run away. I know it sounds a bit strange, but I really like getting charged by cats on foot. Lets you know you're alive. Gets the blood pumping, adrenaline soaring. I'm going to take one last little gander towards the Juma Dam on Mvubu Road. I'm going to go over the bumpy section. Definitely like someone punching you in the kidneys. I don't know how Jandre thought that felt like a massage. Chris Rogue says she'd be most scared of malaria carrying mosquitoes. Now, I can't believe it. I'm going to sound like my dad, and I'm going to use one of my dad's favorite sayings that we grew up on. Malaria is not serious if you treat it seriously. What he means by that, if you pick up malaria early when it's in a human body, it's very, very easily treatable. I've personally had malaria just under 30 times. So I'm on 29 times. One more time for the big 3-0 malaria. But if you catch malaria very quickly, and if you've had malaria as much as my family has, you sort of know within about 5 minutes of waking up that you've got malaria. One of the best ways is you lie on your left side, you take your hand, you put it on your hip bone, and then push onto your stomach. If it's incredibly painful, it means your spleen's enlarged and you've got malaria. And it's almost as good as a blood test. We also do keep fingerprint blood tests. And malaria is not serious if you treat it seriously. Malaria only becomes dangerous if it's left untreated for over a week or so. And I've had quite a few different strains of malaria as well. But if you catch it early, like the last bout of malaria I had, I actually continued doing game drives. I was barely sick for 2 days. So it doesn't seem like anything has made its way towards the Juma Pan. And that's probably rightly so, because there's lots of puddles of water all around. So while those puddles are there, the animals are going to take advantage of them, not having to travel between food and water. But from myself and a dangerous dish, it's been wonderful having you on the back. Unfortunately, Catterday has proved a little bit difficult, but we have got the sunset safari to rectify that. Hopefully lots of lions and leopards all over the place. If not, there's still so many fantastic creatures to look for in this winter wonderland in the African bush. So we will see you on the sunset safari for the last little bit of drive. Let's go see how Jamie's faring on Arethusa.
For the last few moments of a quiet sunrise safari, the cats, as Brent said, have proved to be elusive. But you never know, we've still got a couple of minutes and we might just come around the corner and find one lying in the road. I do have to tell you though, in the year, over a year that I've been working here, I have never heard the Game Drive channel so quiet. It's actually made me worried. I tested my radio, I swapped around, I tried to see whether or not it was something not working on my side. Oh, this road is so smooth! It's amazing! Having just been dragged. But no, it's just quiet. I don't know where everybody's gone, but it's just a quiet morning on this lovely winter's day. Oh, we will have to try again for the sunset safari. Having a discussion just recently with the guides from Simbombili and Arethusa, talking about the leopard territory shift, and there's a very, very clear shift with shadow coming more and more onto Juma. So that is exciting news for us. It means we can spend a bit more time working out exactly where her favorite spots are on this western side of Juma. Shadow is Karula's daughter, and she also has a tiny little cub with her, just a month younger than Karula's. And Dispatch, who is our new viewer, who I think might have been bitten by the bug. It's an absolute pleasure. I'm glad that you've enjoyed it. Dispatch says that they've learnt more in the last three drives than they have in other circumstances. So that's wonderful to hear. I do hope you'll stay with us, because there's just so many wonderful things we can show you and teach you about, and that the animals can demonstrate. And there's so many characters you have yet to meet out here. You have yet to see Sandile or his mother Shadow or her new little cub that James calls Zara. Nobody else calls her Zara, but James calls her Zara, which I have to admit I quite like as a name. I do like the name Zara. And then there's a whole other, I don't know, vast, wide expanse for us to explore with you. So I think Dispatch might be our newest addict to the live safari. I'm sure there are plenty more as well. And I'm really thrilled that we can keep you entertained. And sometimes the mornings are quiet, although we've had lots of antelope and different interesting things to look at, and birds from Brent's birds. But it makes those wonderful surprise sightings even more exciting. And there you go. Dispatch, who is on fire on Twitter this morning, says, is this a quiet day, or should we try that whole sentence again? I'm sorry, Dispatch, it was beautiful and I mangled it completely. One more time. Is this a quiet morning, or is it just the calm before the storm? Well, you'll have to stay tuned for this afternoon's sunset safari to find out. And it could indeed be the calm before the storm. We've got lions everywhere, we've got leopards with several sets of cubs, and at some point our elephants have to come back onto our traverse area. They've got to return to us, and we will hopefully find some of them for you on this afternoon's sunset safari. And Dispatch, I look forward to and all new viewers, I look forward to introducing you to our hyena clan as well when they decide to return. Unfortunately, we have now run out of time for our sunrise safari, unless there is a cat in the next 30 seconds somewhere here. We are going to be saying a big farewell to you all. So a thank you to Jandre for his fantastic camera work and his jovial company on this beautiful morning, as well as to Jerry and Chelsea in final control. Most importantly, a big and vast thank you to all of you watching our live safari. Hope you enjoyed us and that you join us in the next few hours. Bye-bye.